Thank you. We are a little tight this morning, so I'm going to be very brief in opening comments, but there's a couple of clarifications I'd like to offer because the room is full of people who are interested in town government and engaged in town government, and I suspect if I asked who reads the shiny sheet, every hand would go up. So there's two corrections or clarifications I need to offer about a couple of things that have appeared just in the last 2 days. I'll do that quickly, and then I want to talk about a couple of things that are right smack in the middle of the town council's plate that you'll be interested in and probably want to stay informed and engaged with. And then we'll go anywhere you want to go with the rest of the conversation this morning. The first thing I wanted to talk about was the in yesterday's paper, there was an article about the collective bargaining meeting that happened earlier this week with the firefighters union. And it was actually, in total, a relatively accurate description of what occurred there. But there was a quotation, which also was an accurate quotation. It was just incorrect information. I want to make sure you've got the correct information. There was a quotation of the attorney representing the firefighters who said that 11 of 14 new hired firefighters in the last year have left the town. It's simply not true. I don't know where those numbers came from. I'm not sure what he was thinking about or what point he was trying to make, but the numbers are completely incorrect. We have had a lot of turnover, and I'll talk about that for just a second here after I give you the right numbers. But in fact, we've hired 25 new firefighters since we started hiring again. We had a hiring freeze. We've hired 25 new firefighters since October of 2012. 19 of them are still with us. There are six who have left to go elsewhere. And that is part of a transitional period in the department that we've been going through. But we are very much at the end of the tumultuous part of the transition, very much into the positive rebuilding part of that transition. I just participated in an orientation with our 10 newest firefighters earlier this week, and they're dynamite. We've got over 1,000 applications for the openings that we've had. We've hired the cream of that crop. They're really good people. The department is heading in a very positive direction. So it's not a crisis of, you know, we're bringing people in and they're just running right back out the door. I wanted to make sure that was clear. Second thing is in this morning's paper, there's coverage of yesterday's Shore Protection Board meeting. And there's an unfortunate misunderstanding. I will say William Kelly is a reporter who works really hard at getting it right and has done a great job at the Shiny Sheet for a long time and usually comes back and double and triple checks things. And unfortunately, in William's article this morning, there was one he just missed. I've had an opportunity to talk with him about it this morning. He understands that, and I think there'll be a follow-up article that'll provide more clarity to it. But it's on an issue that's of particular importance today because we're all going to go to town hall shortly and we're going to talk about it in the town council meeting, related to the storm surge concerns. There's other concerns as well about the proposed deepening and widening of Lake Worth Inlet. But the potential for the storm surge to be greater and creating, you know, more damage to the island and to the other surrounding area based on the hydraulics of a deepened and widened inlet is a very real concern, and we don't think it's been adequately examined yet. Well, they did a modeling of the 100-year storm, and our perspective on that is, you know, that for the storm that has a 1% chance of happening every year, that doesn't really reassure us at all. We'd like to see some modeling of storms that are more frequent and see what the impacts would be expected to be to see whether or not, you know, there's a justification in trying to be reassured here or whether it's just wrong, and that becomes one of the several arguments against the project proceeding. But in any event, yesterday what this was about was the Shore Protection Board taking a look at the question of whether or not the bulkheads on the lakeside are high enough. As part of their mission, they look at lakeside issues as well as oceanfront issues. We've done years of exhaustive work on the oceanfront. So with a 10-year plan now in place, they're shifting their attention over to the lake to see, is there something we ought to be doing over there in terms of public policy and maybe requiring that the bulkheads be higher? That's something that a lot of us have had a gut feeling that maybe those bulkheads ought to be higher to keep rising water in the lake from coming onto the island. As it turns out, the answer to that is that probably wouldn't be prudent public policy, be a lot of expense and a lot of trouble that wouldn't solve the problem, because being on a barrier island, our water table is so high that when the lake level rises and stays up for a few days, as it would after a major storm, when the rainwater is collected into the lake and takes a while to dissipate out into the ocean, it would when there is storm surge coming in from the ocean. There's a lot of different times when we can have that phenomenon where in the lowest lying areas of the island, the water table actually comes up to the surface. You'll see some ponding in areas where it's not from the rain that fell down, it's from the water that came up through the ground. So because of that, what will happen if we raise the bulkheads is we're going to trap water. And Paul Brazil, our director of public works and registered engineer, who was the one who was delivering this news to the Shore Protection Board yesterday, made a comment that the solution, the better approach, rather than having a major program of the town to raise bulkheads or do any other kind of infrastructure, would be to have a higher first floor elevation in the homes. That came out as raise the structures, and infrastructure will follow later. And so the impression that might leave a reader with is, you know, we're telling all of you that you need to raise up your existing homes, which is not the intent. And, you know, we're going to get around to thinking about whether there's something the town can do about this some other time. And that's not the intent either of the conversation. So I wanted to make sure that that was clear. We do think, in fact, that when new homes are built, they need to be at a higher elevation. It's actually been some action recently by the town council in that regard. And we'll take additional consideration of that aspect of this, of how the way we build on the land in Palm Beach might be able to be done more intelligently and more, you know, to provide more protection. But it's not quite how it came out yesterday. I want to make sure you understood that. That issue, the deepening and widening of the inlet, will be considered in its fullness, not just the storm surge issue, but the broader set of concerns that exist around that proposed project, proposed by the Port of Palm Beach and the Corps of Engineers, and a great concern to many people in the community and outside of the community in our region. That's going to be on the town council's agenda at 11 o'clock this morning, and so is a seawall project that is proposed for the area between Wells Road and Sunrise Avenue, because that area, from some recent erosion after Hurricane Sandy about a year and a half ago, became exposed for the first time in many years, and we have an opportunity to do some maintenance work there before we come in next winter and do a beach nourishment project and bury the wall in sand again. So there's a partnership there that we've been working towards with the residents who are directly affected and the actual owners of that stretch of seawall. And that will come to a decision one way or the other, I believe, today in front of the town council. So those are the two main things that we'll be addressing at 11 o'clock, and we welcome all of you to make the trip down there with us here in a few minutes. The only other thing I wanted to talk about by way of opener, actually two other things, just a quick reminder. I know I don't need to remind you because the Civic Association has been very active with this and will continue to be in the preparation and the run-up to the March 25th referendum, but there is an important issue pending before the town. There's some very strong feelings on both sides of the issue. I'm not here to talk about which way you ought to go, but it's important that when the PUD-5 is voted on March 25th, that everyone turn out and let your vote count in that process, particularly because there is so much at stake. I think the one thing that both sides agree on, the reason that both sides are so passionate about the issue, is it's protecting this community and making sure that in the years to come, it's as special of a place as it has always been, and you know, what we enjoy today. So it's critical with so much at stake and such an important issue for the community that you all learn what you need to learn about and make your own mind up and come out and vote. And finally, on the coastal program, which is another thing that the Civic Association has been very involved in, providing information to the community and advice to the town about over the years, we do now have a program. The great news from the actions of this past year is that town council has adopted an $85 million 10-year program. There's projects in most of the areas of the town. It'll involve a lot more sand. It'll also involve some structural work. And so after years of planning and doing some spot work, we're now going to go back into a very aggressive construction program beginning next winter with work in several different areas of the town. And importantly also, later in the year, that decision was made last summer, and then in the fall, after much input from everyone in the community and a lot of different perspective about how to fund this program, the decision was made to stick with the simplest approach, which is to fund it through ad valorem taxes rather than creating a complicated way to distribute the costs differently than that. Again, quite a lot of viewpoints shared, some people who felt very strongly about it being one way or another way. After sorting all through that and hearing from the community, the town council decided to do that through the taxes. And so my heads up to you about that is, come your tax bill next August and to be paying next winter, there will be an increase. For the first time in many years, you're going to see a tax rate increase And it's going to be specifically tied to the cost of the 10-year coastal program. It's not going to be because of any new growth in the operations of town government. We've done a lot over the last 5 years to slim that down to a more leaner operation. We're not going to just grow it back up. But we'll have a lot more information coming out about that in the months ahead as those decisions get made and you get ready to pay your taxes. So I don't know that I did that well because I'm ending up on taxes as we segue into your questions. But what would you like to talk about?
Flood insurance.
Flood insurance.
How that works into what you just discussed.
Sure.
About rising of the,
absolutely.
Of the water table.
Okay. There's two separate elements to that. There's the federal legislation that is intended to eliminate the subsidies for federal flood insurance so that areas that are more liable to flood have to pay a higher, in some cases a very much higher, substantially higher premium for in order to obtain the flood insurance. That's a great concern to any barrier island and certainly is to us. So fortunately there's federal legislation to postpone the implementation of what Congress had approved because there was such an outcry about it because it kind of taken it back to do it over. We don't know how it's going to end up, but at least there's some time and some thought and effort being put into making sure that it is fair and all thought through in terms of all the implications. It's on the surface of just saying there's been taxpayer subsidy for something that benefits a relative few compared to the whole country. You could rally around that and say, well, that makes some common sense. But then you've got that relative few that are, immediately and overwhelmingly burdened by that change. So, the change may not be as great in the end, and it may be phased in a way that makes it more palatable. We don't know for sure what the outcome is going to be. But it's helpful, at least, that Congress has decided to take a pause.
And the mapping part.
On that. And then, yes, the second piece of it is that there was some very flawed engineering work that was done on the front end of this. To identify new, what they call flood insurance rate maps. So the predicted area that would be flooded in storm events of different magnitude, those maps, after years of work, were unveiled within the last year, I think it was last fall, and they didn't make any sense to those of us who live or work in these areas that are affected. And so we had some engineering vetting done of it, and there doesn't seem to be a proper analysis that's been completed there. So on that, we also were given some additional time. We pushed back immediately. We weren't the only ones. Throughout South Florida, there's been a tremendous reaction to it, and through other parts of the country as well that would be affected by these changes. So they postponed the implementation of the maps to allow for more input. We've now provided that additional input, and again, it's subject now to the federal government going back and reviewing the additional information we provided, and then they'll need to decide, are they going to bully on with the implementation of those maps, or are they going to make some modifications based on the points we've made? We're, I would say, relatively more confident. The premiums issue is a really, a national level political issue. I don't have the same level of confidence that that'll necessarily work out for us to be, really happy with the outcome in the end, but we're going to keep working on it. This other issue is a highly technical issue. They simply got it wrong the first time, and we have a greater level of confidence that now that there's been an opportunity for more input, that the map should be corrected. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
I know you can't say yay or nay for voting on March 25th, but could you just give us a briefing of the pros and cons of voting yes or nay?
Actually, not to be too cute, I'm looking for Ned.
I left the room.
I know there's going to be opportunities to come into settings like this in the next few weeks and address just that issue, and I think that's better, in part because I'd like to cover a broader set of issues today, and in part because there are people who know more about the PUD-5 than I do.
Sure. Okay, I could take 2 seconds on that if you want. This is PUD-5 is an alternative.
I'm sorry, I just didn't know who you were.
Bob Wright. I'm the president of Palm Beach Civic Association.
Okay.
It's an alternative to the current zoning, which is designed to encourage preservation rebuilding. It makes it easier to do the preservation work and rebuild under that than it is under the other one. But it's an alternative. It doesn't exclude. You can continue on. You can approach it from two ways, the current zoning, or you can choose PUD 5. And that's really what it's all about. It's an alternative. PUD 5 is the 1977. I mean, the current zoning is the 1977 design, which is really kind of a strip mall zoning where the cars are all parked out in front. That's sort of the history. It's an alternative, can be chosen or not chosen.
We have found that probably the most helpful way to understand this is to come on a what we call walking tour, a Civic Association walking tour, and we're going to do that again the Friday before the referendum. We're going to start at the abandoned gas station, and we're going to be there with Councilman Mike Pasillo, and we're going to just walk around the block, and he points out every building, and he says, you can do this, you can't do that, this is the problem, and answers all the questions. So please come to that if you can.
I think there's a model that we paid, the town paid $35,000 for, which is sitting in the town council chambers, and it's going to be discussed today as to whether that model should travel, so to speak, and the recommendation is not. But however, the people that are opposed to the PUD 5 are going to have their bill show on the model with these little toy buildings, what it would look like if it was built out altogether. So that's the only way that you can really understand this thing, is to see how it will look if it's totally built out according to the PUD 5. And then there's a good way to make your decision based on what you see. And that will be, it's coming along, I understand, in a short period of time.
My issue is safety.
Yes.
For the citizen.
Safety?
Yes.
A particular aspect of it? Or just in general, what do we do to make sure that the community stays secure?
Yes.
Sure. We have a first-class fire and rescue department for when bad things happen, when someone needs help. Particularly here, that's medical more often than it is fire, but they're well-trained in both areas. Tremendous, state-of-the-art equipment and continuous training and a very high level of service that we provide through the three stations. So there's always someone close by who can get to you within 4 or 5 minutes if you need that most critical help. And then on the ongoing, and within that department, there's also a fire prevention bureau, but it's really a lot broader than just fire prevention. There's a lot of information that they share with the community about things you can do to make your home more secure. How to use things like the automatic defibrillators that are really pretty simple now, the CPR training and so on, so that the entire community can be involved in helping make sure that we all last as long as we can. On the other side, there's the police department maintaining the security of the community every day. And there we've added some additional tools lately that have been very important for us, with cameras that are around at various locations around town. They're at the bridges, they're at the southern entrance to the town, and they're in other locations throughout the community that provide us an ability not so much to be watching in real time. I know there's been some concerns that people have had about that. It's not Big Brother, but it is a deterrent to those who would come and do crime. The police have often said, even though there's crime prevention is a phrase that we've heard a lot of over the years, it's not so much crime prevention as it is crime redirection, because somebody who's going to commit a crime, either because they're just not a person of good character or because they're a person in a desperate situation or whatever it might be, they're probably going to commit that crime. We're probably not going to stop them from committing that crime. And so what we do in any community, and it's a very high priority here in the town of Palm Beach, is try to make sure they don't come and commit that crime here. And we've been very successful at that, at keeping the crime rate low. And what the cameras do is twofold. The fact that people know that they're here discourages the criminals from coming and doing crimes on the island. It doesn't mean we have zero crime, but it means that we have quite low crime rate compared to normal. And equally important, it's an ability for us to go back to the particular cameras when there has been a crime committed. We can go to cameras that are near the area where the crime was committed and pinpoint who was moving in and who was moving out and who looked suspicious in the area and so on. We've had quite a number of crimes already, and the camera system has only been in place for the last year or two. Quite a number of crimes already that have been solved because somebody did come over and actually commit a crime, but then we were able to pinpoint on the camera system and prove that they were here and that they were the ones who committed the crime. So that's a big step forward from us, in addition to just the professionalism and the training and the equipment and so on for the police officers as well. Yes, sir.
Several years ago, there was an incident where a fire alarm went off in the Midtown area here, and it took 9 minutes for the fire rescue to respond. Took a while, but the response that they gave was they had two other things that they had to respond to, and
right.
All their resources were otherwise engaged.
Right.
And I asked at the time, why was it that they always seemed to send two pieces of equipment with four employees
sure.
to every call? And they said, well, we might have to carry a 400-pound man down a spiral staircase.
Right.
And how do we do that? And I suggested they just ask.
Sure.
When they make a call, it seems counterproductive.
Right.
Every time I see to send two pieces of equipment and
yes.
four people
yes.
to one place for something that could be handled by one.
People are going to think that I asked you to ask the question.
I've been pushing this.
Yeah, and actually those protocols have been changed. They're not. It's not like throwing a switch and it used to be this and now it's that, because of the impact of the decision, because of what's at stake in terms of providing the right assistance to people. When we get the call, we want to make sure we send enough resources to
sure.
address what needs to be addressed. So, but they have scaled that back already within the fire rescue protocols. There are certain calls that we don't send vehicles to anymore. And just at the last council meeting, staff recommended and the council approved buying a piece of equipment that will be replaced. It's called a Quint, and it replaces. It replaces a ladder truck and a fire engine with one piece of equipment that is a fire engine that has the ladder on it. It as we were preparing to bring this to council, I was talking to the staff about it. I was thinking, why did it take us until 2014 for somebody to come up with a Quint? But anyway, it's so logical to do this. And what it means for us is we're going to be able to take even another step in the direction of exactly what you've described, because part of the choices that we've had to make previously in responding to calls involved who was driving the two separate pieces of equipment. And now in the one station, there's going to be just the one. When we replace the second ladder truck, which is a few years away, but when we do that, that'll also be replaced with a Quint, and we'll have the same advantage at the second location. So and those two locations up here at the north, we don't have a ladder truck because we don't have tall buildings that are served, but at Midtown and in the south, we have the ladder trucks. So one of the things that'll happen in being able to have a little more flexibility with our staff is that we're going to increase the staffing at the North Station and be able to run four people out of the North Station on every call. Historically, we've only been able to run three, which provides some, it limits us in some ways depending on the nature of the call when we first arrive. So overall, the safety of the community everywhere should be improved, not just at the location where the trucks exist.
Peter, considering the problems we have with the Flagler Bridge,
yes.
do you see any role for the town concerning the proposed construction of high-rises on the West Palm Beach side of the Middle Bridge?
I think there are reasonable concerns, yes. I think that, kind of back to the earlier theme, there's very little that the town can do about a land development decision that's made under somebody else's rules by somebody else's governing body where there's private property owners' rights involved. So yes, more people, more traffic in the vicinity of the bridges. There's some impacts there that we have to be mindful of and do what we can to address in terms of the decisions we make, but there's a lot of that's beyond our control here in town. Yes, ma'am.
Curiosity. How many cameras and where are they?
I can't tell you where they all are. I can tell you that there's now at least a couple of dozen, and it's growing. We're expanding the system.
That's great. That's good.
Each year we're adding cameras.
I was wondering, do you publish any sort of a crime report?
Yes. Absolutely. Yeah. Every month, the police department summarizes the statistics from the past month, as well as taking that data and sort of adding it to the body of data about what's gone on in the last year and in years past.
So is we'd be it happy. Up or
I'm sorry.
What's the trend? I'm particularly interested.
It's way down from years back, and then it bounces along a little bit. We have periods of time when it goes up a little bit and the police deals with that and it goes back down a little bit. The trend has been downward for an extended period of time and is currently at rates that are, you know, historically low for the last few decades.
What's important?
Yes, absolutely. Yes. And by time of day and day of the week, there's a tremendous body of data available. We'd be happy to share it with you.
And then the other thing I was wondering is, I thought that there have been cameras on the bridges for years, but you're saying this is a new thing?
There have been cameras at the bridges, but not in other locations throughout the town. And what happened was the cameras went on the bridges maybe 8 years ago, I'm going to guess, around that time, somewhere between 6 and 10 years ago. And as that first generation camera, which was better than nothing, but not what we have with the current technology, as that was coming to the end of its useful life and we were replacing it, the system got expanded and significantly improved with much higher resolution. We have many more cameras. They're much better cameras. They're all centrally controlled now from the police department. They can the system is centrally controlled. You're quite right that the idea of the cameras at the bridges is not brand new, but the camera system is a much more powerful asset to the community now than it was.
On this license,
I think that's important.
A lot of people don't understand it.
Sure, the system, part of the system. Not every camera is a license plate recognition camera. Some of them are not, but the ones that can are set up intentionally to read the tags will. We call them pings. They'll ping the dispatchers when somebody who's got a warrant out for their arrest is comes across the bridge, so that we know who they are, or at least we know the person of ill repute who owns the vehicle. You know that vehicle has come onto the island. We know where they've come onto the island. In real time, we can dispatch a police officer to be there and stop them and deal with the situation. So we've had quite a number of those. And we can use it. We don't use it a lot. Again, this is the purpose of this is not to be Big Brother, but it is to make the community a safer place. We can set into that system also markers so that if there's a reason because of some ongoing investigation or some other purpose where we need to put in a license plate that is not somebody who's got an active warrant, but just somebody who we need to know when they've come across because we need to talk to them about something. They can enter a license plate in and get the same ping that tells us that person's here.
You may want to mention closure rates, too. On
sure, yeah, that's a good point. One place where we really stand out, and this is the testament to the value and the hard work of the police officers and the detectives. We've got a tremendous team of people in the police department, and the closure rate is the measure of all the crimes that are committed, how many of them lead to, you know, an arrest and a charge. And our closure rates are far above the national norms. Now, I got to tell you, the sad part about public safety in our country and law enforcement in our country is, bad folks get away with a lot of stuff. So closure rates nationally are, depending on the crime that's involved, as low as 10-15%. We run, for certain crimes, higher than 50%. For a lot of crimes, we run in the 30-50% range. But we're, three times better than a normal police department out there in the world. So, it's a great challenge to solve every crime, but we investigate every crime, which is a good start towards having a high closure rate. But there's a lot of communities they do a triage of the complaints they get and decide that some aren't even worth investigating.
You talked earlier about the transition in mainly public safety people in terms of coming and going.
Correct.
Could you give us a little more color and a little more background on that and tell us where we are?
Absolutely. We went through a period of time that I consider our accountability period. We had a lot of unfortunate things happen. Some of them were directly the result of individual employees behaving badly. Some of them were part of a process that we all went through in terms of shrinking staff and addressing budgets and paying benefits that were a broader set of issues that created some challenges. You know, it was a difficult time for the community. It was a difficult time in those two departments and for the whole town government. But as we went through that, the main focus that we had, not just in those two departments, but in all town departments, was maintaining our professional standards and our service to the community. That was preeminent. We knew we were going to experience a period of time when we were transitioning from what had been, a relatively easier task of managing in a time of plenty to all the challenges that come with, you know, less resources and, you know, some chafing at the changes that had occurred. And people, understandably, at a human level, wanted it to be like it was, but it would never again be like it was. So as we went through that period of time, it couldn't be overnight. It couldn't be something that was, you know, a month or 6 months, or, you know, it had to be a period of years. And we knew that in order to get through that time, we had to be vigilant about not tolerating lack of productivity and bad behavior and disloyalty to the community that, while we might understand it at a human level, would lead to a breakdown of the standards of the community and would lead to a less safe place to live. So we didn't do that. Instead, we took a very hard line, a very rigid stance on enforcing our expectations and our rules and regulations, and it led to quite a number of disciplinary actions, and it led to quite a lot of dissatisfaction. And it was hard.
It's unfortunate the shiny sheet loves to sell papers.
Well, and here's what I would say about that, what we were reading last fall. We got through that period of time, and it's been now well over a year since that accountability period ended. We are in a period now that is not just looking to a brighter future, but creating that brighter future, and we've been at it for a while. So, as I said, since October of 2012, we've been hiring new police officers and firefighters. It is true, it's a fact, that during the difficult time and as we've gone through the transitional period, we've had a far greater amount of turnover in these positions than we usually do. That's a fact. It is not a fact that the departments are any longer in any kind of turmoil. There was a period of time 3 and 4 years ago that they were in turmoil, and we were managing that turmoil. The turmoil has long since passed. There are very positive, very committed employees. Anybody who's not with that program is not anymore acting out in a way that is disruptive and preventing their teammates from being effective. So I'm all kinds of excited about where we go from here. The new employees that we're hiring, we've been accused of creating a training ground. People are going to come in, they're going to get some experience, they're going to go someplace else. Some employees are going to do that. It happens with every organization. It has happened here before. It will happen. We're a different kind of community, and not every employee, particularly not every police officer or firefighter, you know, comes here and find that it's the place that they want to have a whole career. But we aren't going to see a revolving door, and we've already seen our exodus. We're not going to see continuous exodus. What we've got now is we've restored some stability. We've got tremendous people. You know, we had so many applicants, we were able to be very choosy about who we hired. Tremendous talent coming aboard. Still some good leadership in both departments to help groom those young people. The troubles are behind us. Yes, sir.
Yes, the Southern Bridge is scheduled to be reconstructed. Is there a timetable for that?
It's a little fluid because the state has made a commitment to the town that they won't have any lane closures at the Southern Bridge at the same time as any lane closures at the North Bridge, and we've got such uncertainty about the North Bridge that they're not able to commit to a schedule yet about the Southern Bridge. They've got a tentative schedule. It's still a couple of years away. But the most important thing for us with all that we're dealing with in the North Bridge is that the state has been very clear and over again has said, you know, we're not going to get the town in a situation where you've got a bottleneck at both places.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Peter, we live in the South End, and our building, like many buildings in the South End, got hit badly in the storm a couple of years ago. As a result, there's a great concern about sand and public safety.
Sure.
We are thrilled, of course, that the town council and the town has approved an $85 million 10-year plan. But some of us have an immediate concern because 3 months from now, we have the start of hurricane season. We dodged a bullet last year. What can we do as private entities, and what can we expect the town to do this year in the event there is a possibility of a major storm?
Sure. The first thing is, let me please try to make sure we maintain reasonable expectations in terms of what the Shore Protection Program is intended to do and what it's not intended to do. It is intended to restore sand into a system that has been starved of sand and manage that sand in an intelligent way. So sometimes that means some structures to help keep it stable. Sometimes it means just putting, you know, more sand in some places and less sand in others. And but you know, there's a lot of science involved in it, and you manage the shoreline in a way that over normal periods of time with less intense storms coming and going, over a period of years, the shoreline will stay in a more stable condition and the buildings on the land side will be better protected. We just yesterday at the Shore Protection Board went through our annual process of looking at what we call the sediment budget, where the engineers show the data of how sand is moving around from one part of the island to another. And the news is good there. The news is that, that there's a lot of sand in the system. And when you look particularly, not in the micro period of just the last year, but at over the long haul, where are we compared to 1990, which is the baseline year that, that it, each new year is compared to, it shows that there are millions of cubic yards of sand that are out there in some areas, not just where we've placed it, but because it does move around predominantly from north to south in town. Not just where we placed it, but elsewhere, there are areas that have a lot of sand that back in 1990 had little or none in the nearshore area to get some protection. So the point of the program is to keep doing that kind of work and to invest ourselves in that continuously so that we maintain a greater degree of stability on the shoreline. We don't get to the critical erosion like we had here. Before we did the original Midtown project in 1995, the waves were hitting the seawall. And then we built it, and the first project did pretty well, but it was the first project. And there wasn't enough sand in the system, and it wasn't a well-vegetated dune, and so on. But we've done it twice since then, getting ready to do the fourth nourishment at Midtown. And now, when you go out to Midtown, what you see is a good, wide, relatively stable beach with a vegetated dune on the backside. Only if we neglect it at some time in the future will it come all the way back to the seawall. There isn't a storm that's going to come and eat that beach in one bite. So that's the goal of what we're trying to do for town-wide long-term protection. Having said that, the in a hurricane condition, if we get a direct hit from a severe hurricane, the program that we're, you know, the Coastal Protection Program isn't intended to protect against that, because there isn't anything we can do where we could look you in the eye and say, don't worry, we got you covered. You know, we've done this beach project, and now a hurricane can't hurt you. Every storm is different, and, you know, the intensity of the storm, the direction of the storm, how long it sits on us, all those different factors, and what the beach condition is at that very moment. You know, there could still be severe damage on the island from hurricanes in the future, even though we're pursuing a very aggressive program of coastal protection.
True, but I think some areas are more vulnerable than others, and I would separate recreational sand from
absolutely
safety sand.
Absolutely.
And I'm thinking primarily of the dunes, which have been just totally wiped out, which in the past were our first line of defense. Then we have a seawall. We've invested some of our own money in upgrading the seawall. But every time we try to do something to improve the situation, to help us at least, you know, like putting rocks in front of the seawall, we're told, no, the town objects to this, the state objects to this, the Army Corps of Engineers objects to this, the federal government objects to this. So we feel that our hands are kind of tied, and we don't really feel down in the South End that the town is implementing any emergency strategies in the event there is a an impending storm.
Okay. Let me cite a real-life example of when we actually had to act in an emergency, and then let me talk about the difference between an emergency and the ongoing program. In 2004, when Hurricane Frances happened, it was eating Old South Ocean Boulevard, if you know the little dog leg there on the north side of, by Tres Vitas on the north side of, of the golf course. It breached that dune. It was literally just chewing away. The waves were chewing away at that road. If the town had not intervened, the road would have gone. Probably the homes would have gone. There's a handful, a small handful, three or four single-family homes that sit up there on the top of that dune. We were able to intervene and take emergency measures and do act first and ask for forgiveness later in the midst of the storm to just throw stuff in there, not irresponsibly. It was the kinds of boulders and sand and things that we knew the state was likely to not punish the town for. But we did what we had to do, and we just called up the state and said, we're doing this. Okay. After that, we got permits to go back and do a permanent solution there, which was to remove some of what we had placed, but leave a lot of it, and then build a seawall at that location, rebuild the road, and on we go. So we are prepared. We've got materials lined up. We've got contractors lined up. We're prepared to take that kind of an action in a real emergency if we encounter another real emergency like that. And our relationship with the state is such that we'll communicate with them and we'll make it happen in a way that we're not going to waste a lot of money. The potential when you do that sort of intervention is always that the state could come along later and say, you have to take it back out. If you don't do it smart on the front end, they're going to make you remove what you put in the emergency measures. So you want to try to do this in a way that's going to be not only solving the problem of the moment, but part of the longer-term solution. Okay, that's a success. That's a case study, a real thing that happened here in town of how we can deal with those kinds of true emergencies when it's act now or you lose it.
Are you
comfortable? We don't get that very much. What we get a lot more of is situations that visually make us nervous. You know, we'd like to have more sand. We'd like to have a healthier dune. Those kinds of situations. But where, from an engineer's point of view, there isn't a building that's threatened. There isn't a roadway that's threatened. In every place in town right now, there is no seawall that is in an imminent danger of failure. There are dunes that are eroded, and we need to put more sand into the system. There are beaches that are low and narrow in certain parts of town, and we need to put more sand into the system. But there isn't an imminent danger any place in town, and so that's where we get back to the difference between those emergency measures, which are very rare, and the broader responsibility we have that we're going to be fulfilling through this $85 million program to maintain a stable shoreline.
Yeah, from an engineering point of view, I believe there's only one set of condominiums in the south end that does not have a seawall, but it's on piers. And it's built specifically so the water goes under, but of course seawall could be an added protection. But there's nothing here in the island, as far as we know, that's in any real imminent danger.
And we'll actually help a private property owner, and we have helped multiple private property owners, and it's the direction town council has given to staff to help you all go to the state and go to the federal government to seek the permits you need to do something for yourself. If you're not satisfied with what the town is doing as part of our overall program and you want to do something that's more specific to your property, we'll help you get into that system. We can't guarantee you a permit, but we can help you know who to speak to and what kind of work you're going to need to do in order to get your permission.
Are you comfortable that in the event of an imminent emergency, you can implement all the plans that you have? Because we were here during Wilma, we were here during Francis, and
yes.
It was chaotic.
It will be chaotic. It's the nature of, yeah, absolutely. In an emergency situation where there's a natural disaster occurring in real time.
Yeah, but some people can't. That's the problem. We have elderly people that it's very, very difficult to transition them out of town.
Well, there's a protocol, I believe Peter knows better than I do, for that. If at a certain point, if it's a real big storm coming, the fire rescue will not go out.
Yeah.
But we do have that armored car, so to speak.
Right.
That tank, right. Or whatever you
call
it.
Yeah.
But there is a point when, these people's lives have to be safeguarded by leaving the island. This is the trouble with the Maury Island. At some point, we have to leave, and those that can't leave, I think they're going to try to take them off as best they can. But in the last analysis, it's their own safety that they have to be responsible for.
Bill, this is why my question was: what can we do prophylactically rather than waiting for
a warning? We have 3 days warning at least, sometimes five.
That's the most important thing. So for human behavior, the most important thing any individual can do is leave the island if the hurricane is coming to the island. From a physical storm protection point of view, the most responsible thing we can do is have a long-term program that's intended to provide greater stability to the beaches. Because doing something, this summer to try to protect against a storm that might come this fall is not the way to try to do shoreline protection.
Thank you. We're in our last 10 minutes.
Yes, ma'am.
May I just comment that on the south reaches, for example, Reach 8, where the dunes have been destroyed, not damaged, but destroyed by the last hurricane, that is a situation of immediate and imminent danger, because there is no protection for the next hurricane, which will happen. So that's like having a building or a house with the doors open. And if the town isn't addressing rebuilding those dunes, then
the town is doing
a lovely job in the center of town.
No, ma'am.
But it's not.
The town is doing in Reach 8 everything that the law allows the town to do. But there are environmental laws that affect what we can do all over town. Reach 2 is in, which is a north end reach, very much the same situation as Reach 8 is in. Down in the south end, Reach 7 doesn't have the same kind of environmental barriers to us as what we have in Reach 8. That's why we've been able to construct beach nourishment there, and we will go back and build beach nourishment there again. So it depends a lot on the particular area that you're in and what's going on in the environment in the nearshore area as to what we're allowed to do under the state and federal laws. In Reach 8, what the town has done historically and is continuing to do today is the maximum that we're allowed to do under the law. We tried to do a full-scale beach nourishment in Reach 8 and actually achieved a state permit in that. We would have achieved the federal permit. We were, you know, in the final stages of receiving that as well. But when the state permit was issued back in 2007, there were people in town and out of town who filed a petition against that, which is their right. There's a window of time after such a permit is issued where the public gets a chance to object to it if they think it's the wrong thing to do. There were objections filed on that. We had a long hearing, several weeks, like a trial, and the town lost. And the DEP was told they had improperly issued the permit and they needed to deny the town the permit to do full-scale beach nourishment there because the environmental impacts would be too great. So from then on, from about 2009 or so when that finally resolved on, what we've been doing is repeated dune restoration in Reach 8 and trying to find a solution to where we might be allowed to do something more. What's ongoing right now, the current chapter of that story, is the town is spending $1 million to complete an environmental impact statement to find out what is the maximum that could possibly be built to protect that part of town. I can't look at you in the eye and say it's going to be anything greater than what we've already been doing. The federal government, which is who's responsible in the end for approving an environmental impact, in fact, they're conducting it. The town is paying for it, but the federal government's engineers are the ones who are actually performing the work. When they come out with the final report and say, this is what, in our federal responsibility for protecting the environment, we can allow the town of Palm Beach to do in this area, when they come out and say that, we're hopeful it'll be something greater than what we've been allowed to do in the past. But there's a chance they may come back and say it's going to be continued dune work, and that's it. If they do allow something greater, then we'll all have a conversation about how to blend that into the program that's been adopted.
I'm only referring to continued dune work in a pre-existing current state of a dune, which was at one point before the last hurricane a dune, and now is shaped like that. So there's a deep collapse in that dune, which holds water, which even creates another additional.
The continued dune work is the work that's specified for Reach 8 in the 10-year program, and the first project for the implementation of that program is intended to be next winter. We're going to go out to bid with it in April and bring the dredgers in next fall and do the work next winter. You can't do it during the summertime because the environmental laws prohibit work from being done during the turtle nesting season. So we can't start until November 1st. But the intent is for next winter to do work at Midtown and in Reach 7 and in Reach 8.
That's wonderful news to hear. So we just have to live one more year.
Yes, ma'am.
And hope to survive.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
What else? Yes?
Just to address the safety of the people who live on the island, it was wonderful. The last hurricane, my husband and I went over the bridge. The police officers were at the bridge asking everybody for their driver's license.
Yes.
And we were thrilled to show them our driver's license because it made us feel very, you know, safe coming over to the island after the hurricane.
Yes.
That the island was protected, and there wasn't any looting, and everything was intact. So
thank you.
You can do that for your employees, too, you know.
Yes.
To have the ID card.
Yes, it's very important.
Good.
Many employees.
Perfect.
Yeah, it was quite impressive.
Right. Thank you. Yeah, there, in any storm, serious storm that knocks out all the power and all of that, like the hurricanes did, that there'll always be two threshold moments of opening back up for a very short period of time, as short as we can possibly keep it, at the very moments after the storm. The island will be completely closed because we've got to get out into the streets ourselves and make sure we find out where the power lines are down and clear the big debris out of the streets and make the place safe to move around. So that takes anywhere from a few hours to a day or so. But when that part is complete, then we reopen for residents and residents' employees and businesses' employees, and we'll maintain that limited access for as long as necessary. It's been up to about 10 days after one of the storms, until the power is restored and it's safe and proper to completely reopen. That, too, we try to keep from being no longer than necessary because we want the town to be able to get back to the community, to be able to get back to functioning in a normal manner. But we do have a more latitude when we're having the checkpoints at the bridges than a complete closure.
Yes, ma'am. I was just following up on somebody else's question. You said that you weren't able to have any impact in the West Palm Beach development because you're in Palm Beach. But I was just wondering, as a municipality, don't you have ingress and egress concerns and traffic circulation and safety issues that would allow you to have an impact?
We certainly can express those concerns, but any more than the city of West Palm Beach saying to the town council, gosh, we're not so sure we really like that project of whatever it might be, that is a private landowner in Palm Beach exercising their private property owner's rights within the boundaries of the law as it exists in Palm Beach. You know, town council is going to make an informed decision. They're going to listen to their colleagues from across the water, but the city of West Palm Beach isn't going to control that decision. And it's likewise with the town related to these towers that are being built. Not for those towers, I wouldn't expect, no. I mean, I don't know the details, honestly, about those projects, but these are private redevelopment projects.
But
that
they don't get any tax breaks, because if they do, then it'd be subject to...
Well, the city may be granting them tax breaks, but they don't pay any taxes to the town, so they're certainly not... There's not a leverage the town could exert in terms of that tax relationship. Yes, sir?
There's a huge bottleneck when you're leaving the island. Particularly exacerbated when the North Bridge is closed.
Yes.
And it's due entirely to the lights in West Palm Beach.
Yes.
And it's incredibly frustrating to be there, see no traffic going north and south.
Right.
And wait 3 or 4 minutes for a light when
yes.
there's 1,000 cars behind you. And I understand that the town of West Palm Beach and its wisdom has decided that they should slow traffic down
yeah.
so people can see the beautiful sights.
There's a misunderstanding about that.
Yeah.
Yes, let me correct the record. The city of West Palm Beach doesn't control those signals. The county does. We have an intergovernmental committee that actually has been working together since the North Bridge was shut down unexpectedly. We've done a lot of communicating. We've installed a lot of new equipment, actually, that helps the county monitor in real time what's going on at these various intersections. And the state has paid for all of that. The state recognized the problem that existed because of their project at the North Bridge. So there's been pretty good partnership there. And what I would admit to you, I get caught in that, too. So I'm not going to suggest to you that it's operating perfectly. What I do want to debunk is this theory, because I've heard this from a few other people, too. West Palm Beach controls the lights, and they're maintaining north-south movement and shutting us down for east-west movement. And that's not it.
I heard that from the police department.
From our police department?
Yes.
Well, I need to correct that within our police department then, because it's not the case.
Even under normal conditions, even leaving the island, 3:30, 4, 4:30,
yes.
to go pick up your kids somewhere.
Yes.
It's very difficult.
Sometimes. My personal experience and what is represented to us by the county whenever we address this with them in terms of what the data shows. They've got all kinds of monitoring that they do of how things move, not just in our corridor, but all around the county. They've got a very sophisticated system. And my experience has been that for some reason the settings don't stick, and I can't explain to you why, and I find it very frustrating too. But when we encounter a period of time where it seems like every time you get to the end of the bridge you have to sit for 3 or 4 minutes, we call up the county, we say it's not working again. And they adjust, and then for a period of time, you get a nice green corridor there when you're leaving the island. And then for some reason, it might be a few weeks or might be a few months, but then it seems to recur. I can't tell you why it's intermittent like that, but I can tell you that it's not intentionally making the north-south movement a higher priority to the east-west movement. And we have some pretty good channels of communication to take quick action when we need to get it back on track.
By the way, it's the same getting on the island.
Sometimes, yes. I completely agree. There are times when it gets out of whack, and we need to have them restore some priority to the east-west. Absolutely.
I apologize to all of you. Normally, we run these about an hour and 15 minutes, an hour and a half. But in this case, there's a special town council meeting at 11 o'clock, and I know, Peter, you have to go, and Bill, you certainly have to go, too. So we want to thank you very much for spending time with us. We thank all of you for coming and come and join us at Town Hall. Thank you.
You mentioned something about emergency vehicles.
Oh, boy.